have you all here. First, let me welcome Professor Rajiv Gowda, who is a professor from an IIM Bangalore background. So kind of resonates with us. Most of us, a lot of us are actually alums from those kind of institutions. It's good to have somebody of an academic background get into a political process as well. It's very refreshing to see. And I was telling him that's a very refreshing trend. And I'm sure a lot of you are aspiring to, if you are aspiring to enter politics, the first table out here is the place to be. I also greet my friends at IIM Network, invite my guest. Of course, Advantage India Mission is involved, HarperCollins. My warm greetings to all of you, all the sponsors, all your friends. I met a lot of you who are alums from 1982 batch, somebody I met just around. I was not even born in 1982. So I'm sure we have a very wide spectrum of people, experience, knowledge. And it'll be wonderful to have all of you share your views on the topic today, which is based on IT and Digital India. It's a huge initiative, not just from this state, not just from the central government, but it's something which has become a landmark of India's economic growth. And it's been around for more than a decade now. So this is a very relevant topic for us to discuss. Now, I know all of you know the numbers, and I will pain you with some of them, but I don't want to start a morning full of numbers. Let me start with a simple incident which happened yesterday. I arrived here late in the evening, I went to, you know, as you all have, we'll always have friends here. So one of my school friends, I was from La Martinia in Lucknow, and I went to meet a couple of my school friends in near Leela Hotel. They live somewhere there. And they have this, they just had this about, so am I supposed to write something? Okay, I'm getting pencils. So yeah, I met these people, a young couple now, and they just had a child about 2 years back. I haven't seen them for 2 years. I just met their little son as well. And I took a small little picture book, you know, a small story book with a lot of pictures, which in my age was a very reasonable gift to give to a young kid. Lots of pictures, lots of colors, that's what you want to give. And then this young chap, 2 years, doesn't go to school yet. He takes his picture book and takes a picture and does like this. And then he throws the book away. And then his mother explains to me, who is in IT, he's trying to zoom it. And it's not working. You know, times have changed so much. You know, realize how much exposed today's generation is to technology and what they expect. Their expectations have changed. And it's not just about children who have access to such devices. I work in a mission, one of the small NGO I had, I still have it in Delhi, works with children who work on streets, street peddlers, you know. And one of the projects we have was in Connaught Place with children who manage shoes, you know, the shoe repairers, lots of them. And there's this whole gang of young children, very aware, 10 years, 11 years, 12 years old, and we try to give them new dreams. So one day I was working with them, and I gave them this mobile phone. I gave them a challenge. Somebody's playing this thing, and I'm not doing this. Okay, this is not operating on my computer. You can just go back. I'm still on the story part, right? Huh? No, I don't know. He has my pen drive. What happened? Signal problem, okay. So yes, we are not still so mature in IT. You can notice that. A lot to do. Anyway, so these children, I gave them a mobile phone. My mobile phone, I said, you play a song on it. Now these children have not, they don't have mobile phones. They do not have iPads, their parents do not have it. And it, just by looking others do it and never doing it by themselves, they're so excited, they huddle around it. And just by looking at how people used to do it and by observing, they had already learned how to play music. This is even people who do not have access to digital devices are able to, wow, thanks, now see, I have access to a digital device which seems to lack a battery, by the way. Maybe it'll work, let's see. Okay. So this doesn't work. And you may want to put a battery in it. We still have not invented non-battery IT devices. Just check, something's wrong. Or maybe I'm still backward. Anyway, so what I'm trying to say here is that we are sitting at this transition point where we are having a generation which is learning to use digital technologies, relying on it. India has 900 million mobile phone users. I'm sure a lot of these mobile phone users are, you know, the second mobile phone you have, the third ones you have. But India has 900 mobile phone users, and we have about 750 million people who are literate. So there are more mobile phone users in India than the number of people who can actually sign and read their own name, which is a significant leapfrog for a country such as ours, and it's a huge progress we have made. India, now this, somebody's operating this. Okay, so you'll do it now. Or you can do it, it's okay. If you want to do it, it's working, thank you. It's working, then that's wonderful. Right, now this should work, let's see. Attempt number three, and it works, Rao. Okay, so India has got 250 million internet users. We know, and this is a statistic from last year because we were writing for the book. This might be wrong, and this is wonderful news if it is wrong, because it means we have grown really fast over the last 1 year. 173 million of mobile phone, of internet users are also using it on mobile devices. Out of this, and this is the good news, is that 53 million mobile internet users are in villages of India. We need to expand it more, but then it's still a lot of number. And nearly half of the total mobile bill which people are paying are being paid on internet. Slightly more than half goes on internet. And that is so true. Look at your bill and you'll find out. You're probably spending 80% of your bills on internet and 20% on calls. But on an average, it's about 51%, which just shows how fast internet has penetrated. There are 109 million Indian users who are on Facebook, which is a huge achievement of its own. We are getting social movements being driven on social media now. This one first. Naukri.com, which claims to be India's number one job portal, has 25 million job seekers, and 11,000 people are registering every day. Now that's more than the number of people registering in Rozgar Mission of the government, perhaps. But this one, a lot of you have jobs, but if you are someone like me who has a job but is still single, there are 40 million matrimonial profiles. 550 crore business. So that's a very unique business model of India. Then you have, and of course, and this one we all probably do. 3 hours and 18 minutes we spend on your mobile phone every single day, out of which half of the time you're spending on an app, which could be a game, which could be, well, usually it's a game, and it could be something else. But I'm pretty sure each one of us has played things like Angry Birds and Farmville and all those kind of things. But imagine the time which one is spending. 3 hours and 18 minutes is the average time spent on a mobile phone by every youth of India. That's almost equal to the amount of time they are spending in school. Right. Okay. And of course, India's IT exports last year, and this year in fact is going to exceed it, IT exports is matching its biggest import, which is petroleum. One stands last year, it stood at $100 billion, the other was at 99. And this year, I'm pretty sure that the IT export, the petroleum price is going down, the IT exports will exceed the petroleum imports. Now, that's all the numbers which I'll show you, so you'll not get bored anymore on that. But look at how the perspective of IT has changed. I come from a state called Uttar Pradesh, the largest state in India by population. one of the most historic places on this planet. And it is also the state which gave India the maximum number of prime ministers, highly politically charged state. Every street discussion, in Bangalore you discuss about IT, industry, entrepreneurship. In UP we discuss about politics. That's it. And everybody is politically literate. Everybody has an opinion on politics, and pretty in-depth opinion actually. They'll like give you the inside version. Now, what happened in 2009, when I was graduating out of IIM Ahmedabad, and a lot of my batchmates are here, in 2009, the largest party of Uttar Pradesh, who was not in power then, called the Samajwadi Party, whose Chunav Chin is cycle, came up with a manifesto where it said that English should be banned and computers, you can consider banning them too because they are taking away jobs. The same party in 2012 elections of state promised free laptops to every youth who does well in exams, and it did it. It is already doing it. It is running the world's largest free laptop distribution scheme, and it's 1 lakh villages, they're ensuring that each one of these villages at least gets one laptop. One youth in the village gets a laptop, the same party. In 2015, in the Delhi election, the biggest promise, for the first time ever, unheard things happened. The biggest promise of all three major political parties, whether it's the Aam Aadmi Party or the BJP or the Congress, was free Wi-Fi. We'll give you free Wi-Fi. And the biggest accusation is that this guy cannot do it, but I can do it. I've got a better plan to give you a free Wi-Fi. To the extent, you know, and look at how the election symbols, election promises are changing, and how the 2014 general election was contested so heavily on internet. And if you remember this one, the reliability of social media is so much that today companies are finding that regular ads do less impact than social media hearsay. You know, the grapevine effect on a social media is far more impactful. To the extent when this starts working, I will show you something. Yeah, this one. Have you seen this? Today when I was searching for this image in the morning, there was an article, this is not a prank. Ola helicopter is not a prank. Ola helicopter is not a prank. And even today, 1 year down the line, people think it's not a prank. Ola, on 1st of April last year, 2015, launched this Ola Air. 1st of April is April Fool's Day. And it launched this thing called the Ola Air, where it promised to get you a helicopter for 500 rupees per hour. And you could track real time, you know, where your helicopter is. That guy's trying to do that. Okay. And to the extent that people believed in it, people believed in our e-com so much that even this kind of an ridiculously, you know, it's very cool actually, but such a wonderful prank went unnoticed. People believed in it. This is the faith which people have on today's India's IT. I was reading about this very famous author, Thomas Friedman, and it's on social media, of course. I'm also 3 hours, 18 minutes on social media every day, probably more. And he says something. He says that when in 1970s, when he was a kid, he was a 10-year-old boy, his parents, his mom rather, used to tell him that, Thomas, you finish the food on your plate because there's a child in India who's going hungry to bed. You finish the food on your plate. There's a child in India who's hungry. You finish it. Thomas, small boy. Today he's a famous author. He's lectures on a lot of topics. And he says, now I've got my grandnephew, my grandniece, and I spend time with them. And then when they don't do their homework, I tell them, you fellows finish your homework. There's a child in India who will take away your job. And this take away your job was something which began with India's IT revolution. But a lot needs to be done. Let's be honest about it. What happens in one city has the potential to change the map of this, the social map of India. I'll tell you, as I promised, I'll tell you stories. I'll tell you two stories. We're working on, long back, about 4 years back, I was working with a very famous education trust, and we were doing a survey in somewhere in Uttar Pradesh. he went to a school, and the, you know, Ekal Vidyalaya, there's one master. So in this case, there were two, but then this guy was missing, this master was missing, schoolmaster. And the children were making all the din, you know, they were noisy kids. So we asked these kids, where's your teacher? Where's your teacher? So the kids replied, you understand Hindi? All of you, anybody? Otherwise, I'll do translation. If everybody understands Hindi, I'll avoid translation because this conversation is in Hindi. Okay. So this kid say, Master Sahab jo hai, Nauwe ki dukaan pe gaye. Nauwa is Nai, Baba. Right? So in Eastern UP, you call it Nauwa. It's Bhojpuri. So Nauwe ki dukaan pe gaye. Theek hai. Aur achhi baat hai. So we'll wait. Kya karega aadmi? For a haircut, he's gone. He'll come back. It's okay. And it's because the attendance is there. So he's there. He came to school. So he'll come back. 15 minutes passed. 30 minutes passed. And we were working with the panchayat guys as well, talking to people, talking. We had really the whole day with us. We were also free. Okay. 1 hour passed. Man, where is he? Oh, Nauwe ki dukaan pe. He's in the barber shop. And then we realized, I don't know what's wrong. And then another hour passed. And then we were about to leave. And we said, where is he? He's not come back. I mean, what's gone wrong? Has Nauwa done something to him or what? So we went to, said, let's check out. Huh? I might be like in trouble or something. We went to the guy, and here's the Master Sahab with scissors. Master Sahab is the Nauwa. So he's the guy who is the barber. He comes, puts the attendance, and goes to his shop, opens that shop, and starts his business every day. And the second is in Gujarat. And this happened recently. So we went to this is a very famous healthcare company. It basically aggregates data on rural health statistics. And then we were there, this PHC is there. They're about, Gujarat state itself will have about 2,000 PHCs. Now this PHC, what happens is, and this is not just UP or Gujarat, this is India. I'm just giving you so that you have something in your mind. Somewhere in the map it is there. We went to this PHC and we saw all the prescriptions are wrong. I'm not a doctor, but there was a doctor. All prescriptions are wrong. When something is happening, he's giving some other medicine. More or less common medicines. Bukhar, yeh bhi khalo. Ulti aari, yehi khalo. Yehi lal goli, yehi lal goli, yehi lal goli. I mean, prescriptions are all wrong. The moment you enter data, it throws that, you know, this is all wrong prescription. See, ask him, why are you doing this? You are going to kill people. So the doctor says, see, हम वो दवा दे रहे हैं ना जो हमारे पास है. वी हैव ओनली दिस लाल मेडिसिन. सो आई एम गिविंग दिस लाल मेडिसिन. हुएवर कम्स आई गिव द सेम मेडिसिन. बिकॉज इफ आई डोंट गिव अ मेडिसिन दे से यू आर नॉट डूइंग अ जॉब एंड आई डोंट हैव दिस मेडिसिन. आई हैव ओनली वन मेडिसिन. आई एम गिविंग दैट मेडिसिन. एंड यू गो टू अनदर पीएचसी यू विल फाइंड दे आर गिविंग अनदर मेडिसिन. देन थर्ड वन इज गिविंग अ थर्ड सेट ऑफ मेडिसिन. ईच वन इज नॉट ट्रीटिंग पीपल ऑन वॉट दे हैव एज एन एलमेंट बट वॉट दे हैव एज अ ड्रग. So you see, the reason of telling you these stories is, you know, this, not this, this is a joke, the one before this, you know, the whole penetration which you saw of IT industry, the kind of money which is generating, the kind of awareness it has created, how will this awareness percolate down to ensure that the medicines as a PHC, you can create a central database where people can order medicines at PHCs in the same way as many of you sitting here could right now on your mobile phones order books or anything else from all kinds of e-com. How will you ensure that the attendance of a teacher is mapped centrally and is accounted for at a real-time basis? Why can't you access data on, you know, government services the way you can access, you can track your Uber cab, where it is, which direction it's turning. It even turns, you know, like if it's turned, it'll show you turning. Why is it that the same thing does not apply to a schoolmaster? Why can't I find out where is he? And we tried this experiment because I ran a small company on mobile apps with Anganwadis. And we did exactly this with GPS tag. We gave them free mobile phones. We gave them a GPS tag with that mobile phone. Of course, you can get that. That's a part of a ready mobile. Any smart mobile phone has that feature. And you can exactly find out in which house they are. and why is it that all this is still being talked about and not already implemented? 2 years back, if you remember, 3 years back, the previous union government, there was a news, I don't know whether it was true or not, but there was a rumor in popular media, in the best of media, that the government is going to give free mobile phones with a recharge value to everyone. I think that was a brilliant scheme. That's the kind of, and he was criticized, of course, everybody criticized, why are you giving freebies? But I don't think it was a freebie, it was a great empowerment. And it's time that we think on making digital India also as a digitally inclusive India. And that's why in the book, this Advantage India book, Dr. Kalam and I, we sat down and we tried to find out what are the stages of evolution and what now? And we found out, you know, the digital age in India began actually with the backbone. India was the country which gave ISP licenses at the cheapest prices ever. ISP license in India went down to the extent of 1 rupee. Now, if it happened today, there'll be a scam. But back then, that was an accepted thing because people in India back then, they had a foresight, and I'm talking about late 1990s, that ISPs, internet service providers, and internet itself would be a backbone for a lot of activities, and hence it should be made as low, as cheap as possible. And India still enjoys one of the cheapest internets because of that foresight. That's how the backbone came in late 1990s, somewhere in 1990s rather. And then this, for a long, long time, the devices were expensive. Then the device revolution came, and that is not far away from now. About 5-6 years ago, you know, with Indian companies actually, Micromax, Lava, all these companies started off with a whole device revolution. So from backbone, we got devices, and that's how everybody started getting mobile phones or internet-enabled devices. Even today, of the top 5 players in the mobile phone space, 3 of them are Indians. 3 of them are Indians. The top one is also Indian. It's not Samsung. It's Micromax. It's an Indian company. Out of the top 5, 3 are Indians. That's the device revolution we saw through. And the third stage came, which is still going on, we're still struggling with it a bit, we have kind of cracked it some way, is language barriers. A lot of regional languages have been incorporated because of the fact that we own devices, we are the ones manufacturing it. The next natural stage was to enable language support. So a lot of language support has come, Hindi and all are pretty evolved now, but still a lot needs to be done. We need automatic translation engines, which is still kind of, everybody's working on it, nobody's coming out with a really cool product on it. The fourth stage, we kind of jump-started the third stage into the fourth stage, was on migration. So people actually migrated onto devices. People learned on how to, digital literacy, for example, which is, as I told you, there are more mobile phone users than literate people. So there was a jump in that, there was a sort of a leapfrog into migration. And the fifth, which is we are seeing now, is actually making money in it. You know, people are doing business on mobile phones. And I'm not just talking about your mobile apps of taxi booking or your e-commerce, but also business which does not have an app at all. The sabzi wala. Or who's able to coordinate with you or the person who takes care of your house. When you're sitting here, there's somebody who's going to take care of your house like an invisible hand, and that person, whatever you call it, whether you call it the housemaid or the housekeeper, whatever you call it, is enabled on a mobile phone. Today they are able to cover much larger regions and many more houses because they are able to coordinate using IT devices. That is also a sort of an e-commerce or m-commerce, whatever cool term you call it. So that's the fifth stage. And beginning from there, we decided that what next? And we identified a set of, and Dr. Kalam was a fan of, you know, he wanted everything to be on cloud. He said we should enable a system where you don't need storage, you need minimal storage. And we should have a system in India, like a national mission. He talked about many national missions. One of them was interconnection of river, and the other was interconnected clouds, water and clouds. So, you know, that kind of architecture almost. So he said that, you know, everything, if India is able to create its backbone, we should look for an integrated cloud network where all these data listen to each other. And that's a big problem. Data in India is a big problem. I've asked a district collector, I'm not name who, but every district collector does it. I asked him, how many villages are there in your area? And he gave me a number X. I asked the DDO, the guy next to him, how many villages? He gave me another number, 10% variation. I asked the district collector 1 week later, how many villages are there in your district? And he gave me a third number. So there's some issue of who owns the data. And that's why it's important to integrate in government services or otherwise, integrate all these clouds into one so that we know what is the real data. So we talked about, of course, the regular ones. We talked about education cloud. We talked about the citizen, you know, the beautiful mission of UID, which has so much potential and which will one day have a lot of impact on India's, you know, things like DBT and identifying beneficiaries and so many other things as a citizen cloud. We also, Dr. Kalam talked about creating things like an innovation cloud, you know. And today, you know, the Prime Minister yesterday talked about 80% rebate on IPRs and all those things. But we could have an innovation cloud where anybody can upload an innovation which could be, and the government could take care of it, something like that, you know, India Innovation Cloud. I don't know whether you heard of the IRNSS. In 1999, when the Kargil war happened, India asked for data on from US. GPS is owned by US, by the way. The US government was asked by Indian government to give us data of infiltration on GPS. We were refused. We never got it. And that meant a lot of trouble. A lot of people lost their lives. A lot of our soldiers could have been saved if we got data on time, and we could not, because the government of the United States owns it. And in 1999, India embarked on a challenge which no other country did it. In 1999, we will invent our alternative to GPS. It started in 1999 with that war. Today, IRNSS, the Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, it's a seven-stage system, seven satellites, IRNSS 1A to 1G. And I think we are at satellite number 5. By the end of 2016 or somewhere in 2017, India will upload all its seven satellites into the space, and India will be the first country in the world to invent an alternative to GPS. Silent revolution. And the best thing is the total cost of this system is $2.25 million GPS. GPS itself, back then, GPS is an older system, so you can do your, you know, what do you call, market conversion to current price. GPS cost $2.6 billion, 11 times. It is 1/11th cost of GPS. It has a higher resolution than GPS, and India will emerge as a global player in positioning systems with this. That's another cloud which we talked about, that data. We had a significant cloud on security and disaster management, on water. Water is a big crisis. You all know what happened in Chennai. We all saw through it. It's a tragic event. But at many levels, it was a human-generated crisis and not a natural crisis. In 1857, actually, when PWD was formed for the first time by the British people, that was the first time the ownership of water was transferred to the state. Maintenance of water bodies became a state's responsibility and not a community's responsibility. And since then, community has almost been an enemy of water. Because the only way to grab land underwater is to remove that water, make it a land, and start ownership. And look at, you know, here in Bangalore itself, you have reclaimed so much water bodies and made it into land. The entire Salt Lake, I was in Calcutta the other day, I was telling them the entire Salt Lake City is a lake, and you've converted it into land. Now, those kind of things are happening all over India. So we wanted one of the cloud network we proposed was waterways. How do you do that? And interconnection of waterways, of water bodies comes from there. So there are many such things. You'll find it in the book. There are 9 such different clouds and how they integrate into each other and how it can enable so many rights and privileges and things which the state can do. And as I conclude, you know, the other day, about a week back, I was in Lucknow. I came from Lucknow, actually. And the same government, which once opposed English and digital devices, which then distributed free laptops, started a scheme, and you should check it on the internet. It's called 1090, Das Nabbe, Hindi mein Das Nabbe. 1090 is a, they call it the woman power line. Now, the state has a reputation. We all know that. And they started this woman power line to curb the issues of harassment over phone, over email, over internet, and that's the start of any large crime. The criminal starts with a small crime, and the smallest crime is they'll go to a mobile phone shop, and the mobile phone shop sells numbers of women. So because you register there, you put your details there, so they know the name, they know the lady, they've seen it, they know the age, and they sell these numbers. So these people will take these numbers, a lot of people, and they will harass. And the state came up with, the same government came up with the policy of 1090, and they established like a call center. You know, there are three different call centers, and they go through three stages, and they're able to address this issue at, you know, they nip at the bud. Because whenever there's a harassment on phone, a lady can call, and they will immediately act. And you'll be surprised by the numbers. It's the first of its kind system in India. And if you go by the numbers, it's a record. It was reported recently in BBC and Sydney Morning Herald, because what they did, so they have tackled, what they did is that they have tackled so far in 2.5 years, 4.6 lakh cases in a single state. Imagine the amount. And in Lucknow itself, we went through that data. Every 1 out of 7 women have access to that service between the age group of 15 to 35. Out of every seven, one woman has accessed this service once. Now imagine the amount of potential criminals who have been knocked out of market by nipping this at the bud. And what these people do, and why Sydney Morning Herald and BBC covered them, was because now they have a list of about 5 lakh potential perpetrators, you know, potential harassers who have been complained once, they have all their numbers. And every major festival, they send them a greeting and a warning. So they send, Happy Diwali, and we are watching you. Happy New Year, and we are there. So, and that kind of, that reinforcement is enabled by IT. And by a state which had a bad reputation in protecting women, had a bad reputation in IT, and the same state has done this. And I'm not advertising a state here. What I'm trying to say is that the people's demand have shifted. And just by one call center, and the entire call center, everything put together, is not more than thrice the size of this room. Everything is there. State of art does not look like a police station. It looks like a very good call center. And the people who are manning it are basically policemen and police women. And it's just beautiful to see. Many such things are happening over India. And I'm doing this because I'm also coming out with a book on grassroots innovations like this, which are changing the face of India in different areas. But think about it. You know, the next big challenge for us is to create Advantage India, and not just Advantage India at the city level, but Advantage India at the last mile level. And that is our biggest challenge. That is also our biggest opportunity. And that was the subtitle of the book. Is from challenges to opportunities. Every challenge is an opportunity. Every single problem which you see today is also an opportunity to solve today. So and there are many such people, I'm sure. I've been through the list of names, the panel discussion, and the people who are going to talk about. A lot of you are doing that. A lot of you are already using IT devices to solve common man's problems. My best wishes to all of you. I love to hear all of you and interact with you. And of course, we've got a professor who will be talking on, I'm sure, something which all of us will love to hear on his perspective, which is academic and political. And I hope the day goes well. All the best. Thank you for being here. You're all welcome.
Economics and Social Sciences, and chairperson of Center for Public Policy at Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore. And he served as the director of the Central Board, Reserve Bank of India. To accompany him, may I also invite Mr. Srijanpal Singh, Mr. Rajendran Dandapani, Mr. Ganesh Tyagarajan, Mr. Chandrasekhar from Plodin Ventures to the unveiling ceremony. May I invite all the speakers to join us in the unveiling ceremony.
Yeah.
Mr. Sumit Jain, CEO Common Floor. Mr. Ganesh V, Head Marketing Communication, Janagraha, and author of the book, The Underage CEOs. Dr. Vikram Venkateshwaran, Marketing Leader and Digital Evangelist. Mr. Vishal Datta, CEO and Founder, Godot Media and Drumup. Mr. Mukund B.S., CEO and Founder, Renew IT. Mr. Tanuj Mendiratta, CEO and Founder, LoanCircle.in, and Founder at Epiterate, which is acquired by Flipkart. Mr. Balaji Muralidharan, Head of Marketing, Ecosystem and Marketplace, IBM India and South Asia. Ms. Devaki Sahasrabuddhe, Co-Founder and Management Group, Greggs. Also, Mr. Vivek Pateshwari, NIM Calcutta and IIT Kharagpur alumnus. Mr. Akshay Agarwal, NIT Guwahati and IIT Raipur alumnus. Mr. Ganesh Tagarajan, Managing Director, Plurin Ventures, is already here.